Hi, my name is Laura Deitch-Weidner. I am from the Center for Devices and Radiological Health, and I'm here to talk about device review. What is an IDE and when do you need one? I have no conflicts of interest to disclose. So here's an outline of topics that we will be going over today. I will discuss when an IDE is needed, different pathways available for interacting with the FDA, and a brief overview of the Breakthrough Submission Program. So IDE stands for Investigational Device Exemption. The IDE regulations provide procedures for the conduct of clinical investigations of devices. They explicitly describe study requirements such as those for informed consent, labeling, monitoring of the study, keeping records, and submitting reports. Initiation of a clinical investigation involving human patients, which is subject to the IDE regulations, also requires approval of the investigation by an IRB before initiation of the study. IDE regulations can be found in 21 CFR 812. An approved IDE application permits a device that otherwise would be required to have FDA clearance or approval before use to be used in a clinical trial, and exempt sponsors from certain provisions of the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act, such as compliance with full good manufacturing practice regulations. At a high level, FDA review and approval of an IDE application is required for a significant risk study performed in the U.S. on human subjects when that device has not been cleared or approved by the FDA for the indication for which it is being studied. So when determining if your clinical trial is subject to the IDE regulations, the first thing to consider is what the device is cleared or approved for by the FDA. In other words, what does the testing of the device support? This is reflected by the indications for use of the device. This gives us specifics about what the device is meant to diagnose or treat and may specify a patient population if there are restrictions. A device's indications for use can be found by checking the FDA's device databases. So when is an IDE needed? The first question is, are you conducting an investigation or study, or are you treating a patient under the practice of medicine? Since this workshop focuses on new and innovative technologies, I will not spend much time discussing practice of medicine. However, it is important to note practice of medicine means that a legally marketed device can be used outside its approved indications by a physician to care for a patient, as long as it is not used in a clinical trial or investigation. But if the device is not being used under practice of medicine, then the next question is whether or not the device is exempt from IDE regulations. Exempt studies are exempt from the IDE regulations and do not require an IDE approval. Studies that are exempt from the need for an IDE are described in 812.2 Part C. For nuclear medicine devices, these may include 510K cleared or PMA approved devices if used in accordance with approved labeling, consumer preference testing, combinations of legally marketed devices, and custom devices, although these are rarely granted this exemption. Some diagnostic devices are also exempt from IDE regulations. However, it is important to note that if the device introduces energy into a subject, then it is not considered exempt. In addition, if the device is used as a diagnostic procedure without confirmation by an approved, medically established diagnostic device, then the device is also not considered exempt. So if the device is not exempt, then there are two kinds of studies that need to comply with the IDE regulations: significant risk studies and non-significant risk studies. Non-significant risk studies do not meet the definition of a significant risk study. These studies do not require an IDE application approved by FDA, as the IRB serves as FDA surrogate. There are a subset of IDE requirements that need to be met, including labeling requirements, informed consent, IRB approval, and others. A non-significant risk study can start as soon as the IRB reviews and approves the study. A significant risk study, on the other hand, is one that presents a potential for serious risk to the health, safety, and welfare of a subject and meets one of the four criteria shown here. These studies are subject to the full IDE requirements. One possible example of a significant risk study is when a device is used to influence the treatment or diagnosis of the subject. If the device is simply collecting information from the patient, then this may not be significant risk. However, if the collected information is then used to make decisions about the patient's diagnosis or treatment, then the study is likely significant risk. A significant risk study can begin only after approval by both the FDA and the IRB. So how do you determine the risk of your study? The first thing to know is that a study risk determination is made based on the study's risk, not on the ratio of benefit to risk. It is also the risk of the study, not the device. Study risk determinations are initially decided by the sponsor of a study. Based on the determination of significant risk or non-significant risk, you can then decide whether to go first either to an IRB or the FDA for review and approval of the study. If you decide that your study is non-significant risk, you would probably want to approach the IRB first, since a non-significant risk study would not need FDA oversight. However, if the IRB decides that your study should be classified as significant risk, then you will need to submit your application to the FDA for approval before the study can begin. FDA can be contacted to help with study risk determination using our Q-submission process. One available resource is a Q-submission, where a sponsor can submit their planned study for a study risk determination. The result of this submission is a formal determination made by the FDA and an official letter indicating if the study is significant risk, non-significant risk, or exempt from IDE regulations. If a sponsor receives a study risk determination decision from the FDA, that decision is final. The FDA is the final arbiter, and the IRB does not need to do an independent risk assessment. Some IRBs may ask a sponsor to submit a study risk determination when they are unsure of the appropriate classification. The guidance documents listed here are very informative, and I encourage you to read through them for more detailed information about study risk and submission types. The second guidance document in particular describes the device operation conditions for magnetic resonance diagnostic devices that FDA considers significant risk. In addition, although my talk focuses on devices and IDEs, the third link provides information on when an IND, investigational new drug application, is needed for radiopharmaceuticals. So in addition to a study risk determination, there are other types of Q-submissions that can be used to interact with the FDA. The culture in pre-market review at the FDA is one of openness and resolving issues interactively where possible. So we encourage you to take advantage of the pathways that have been developed for you to communicate with us in all phases of the review process. A common piece of advice from the FDA to sponsors is come early, come often. This is especially the case with new and innovative technologies. This list does not reflect all types of Q-submissions, but instead focuses on the most common. A pre-submission allows for sponsors to receive feedback on specific questions from the FDA. For example, if you're planning on conducting an IDE clinical trial for your significant risk study, a pre-submission meeting is a way to receive feedback from the FDA on your draft clinical protocol. An informational meeting is a type of meet and greet in which the sponsor intends to share information with the FDA. This is often used for new technologies to allow the FDA to become familiar with the device prior to a pre-submission or a pre-market submission. There is no official feedback. However, there is often interactive dialogue during the meeting. The Breakthrough Program is intended to help patients have more timely access to certain medical devices by expediting their review. There's more information on this program in the next slide. So the Breakthrough Devices Program is a voluntary program for certain medical devices and device-led combination products. A breakthrough designation request is a mechanism by which sponsors request entry into the Breakthrough Devices Program, and FDA renders and communicates a decision on the request. To be eligible, the device must meet the first criterion and at least one of the subparagraphs listed in the second criterion shown here. If the device is found to meet breakthrough criteria, then FDA intends to help expedite the development and review of these devices through options such as sprint discussions, prioritizing the review, efficient and flexible clinical study design, and others not listed here. For more information, a link to the breakthrough guidance is included below. To summarize the take-home messages from this presentation, device clinical trials performed on human subjects may be subject to IDE regulations depending on how the device is being used in the study. An approved IDE application is needed to conduct a study determined to constitute a significant risk to the rights, safety, or welfare of subjects in compliance with the full IDE regulations as needed. For trials determined to be non-significant risk, the IRB acts as a surrogate for FDA, IDE approval, and compliance with the abbreviated IDE regulations is required. Study risk determinations, either non-significant risk or significant risk, are made based on the risk of the study, not on the ratio of benefit to risk. The breakthrough program is intended to help patients have more timely access to certain medical devices by expediting their review. Lastly, the FDA is available to help with study risk determinations or before submission of an IDE application. Here are some helpful resources for IDE preparation and submission. CDRH Learn has many videos about compliance and pre-market submissions. Device Advice is the CDRH website that contains helpful information about all regulatory pathways in CDRH, including the IDE pathway. The Division of Industry and Consumer Education, or DICE, is a great place to start if you have any questions whatsoever about use or development of a medical device in the future. Thank you for your time. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them during the chat session, or you can feel free to email me at the email address shown here. Thank you.